Why don't you continue worshiping with us as we continue to give praises to the author and the finisher of our faith, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Great is thy faithfulness, oh God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, in thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in plentiful witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. Great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord.
It's so good to know His mercies are new every morning. Morning by morning, they're new and they're great. In His faithfulness, He's always faithful to us. So I hope you're excited to be at church this morning, and I hope you're excited about being at church again tonight. 8 baptisms this morning. Wasn't that phenomenal? Wasn't that great? And we're still not done. We invited people to tell us about decisions they had made in revival, and we have more and more people telling us how God worked in their heart and their lives throughout that week. And we already have, I know, about five baptisms lined up next week. I mean, I hope you don't take that for granted. I hope we never lose the thrill of seeing souls saved, lives changed, people being baptized, people surrendering to the ministry. I hope that never gets old for us. I hope it's something we look forward to. We anticipate God doing something. At this time, I'm going to ask Brother Ryan Pretz to come. Brother Ryan's going to come, and he's going to voice our prayer tonight, opening our service. Plus, he's going to join us in praying for the transition time, praying for wisdom. You can get a mic right over here, brother. He's on white, Brother Aaron. He's going to pray for that time of transition, and that God would give us wisdom and direction in this time.
Brothers, sisters, let's come together now to the Lord, and let's pray together collectively as one soul, talking to our Father. Let's bow and pray. Heavenly Father, I am so grateful, so blessed to have the opportunity to come to you right now. You are so holy, and I am so sinful. We all in here are. But because of your Son, we can come directly to you. We give you credit. You are the one and true God. You created the universe, the earth, everything in it, and everything on it, including me and every person in here. This church is yours. You created it. If it wasn't for you, we wouldn't exist. Lord, Philippians 4:06 tells us to come to you not worrying. Don't worry. Give thanks to you and believe and have faith that when we pray to you and ask for something in particular, that you will grant our request. You may not grant our request in our timing, but it'll be in your timing and in your way. Lord, before we come to you and ask some specific things tonight, I want to come clean, and I want everybody else in here to come clean as well. We know that you made the first people on this earth, and we know that they did not obey you and they sinned, and because of that, the price is spiritual and physical death. The only way to overcome that spiritual death is to believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for our sins. He lived a perfect life, he performed miracles, and he led a life that we can look at as a guide on how to live ours. We'll never live up to him, but we can certainly try, and with the help of the Holy Spirit, we can work to be sanctified and become more and more like him. Tonight, I ask that everyone in here to dig deep in their heart and ask for forgiveness of your sins. Repent of your sins now, before we go to the Lord with some specific prayers. Lord, I know I'm a sinner. Please forgive me of my sins and worship clean. Lord, this church is suffering from a loss. Steve Proctor was a great man. He was a great leader. I know of no one better. But Lord, he's moved on and he's doing things for you in a different way now. And it's time for somebody else to come in and replace him. He will not be replaced, but there's somebody to come in here and do the job that he did. And Lord, I think I know who the person is that's right for that. But is the person that I think is right, is that the person that you think is right? Does the person to my left and the person to my right think that the same person that I think is right for them? I don't know, but I'm asking for a miracle. The miracle I'm asking for is not for everybody to be on the same page with thinking, oh, this is the right person, 100%. We want this person. What I'm asking for is a miracle for everybody in here to get on the same page with, hey, there's a chance that the person that I want may not get this job. But let's pray together that the person that does get it, that they do it correctly, that they are Holy Spirit inspired, and that they take the staff that we currently have and not come in and try to break it apart, but build it up. Give encouragement where encouragement is needed. If the staff has some flaws, let the leader come in and be able to work with those flaws and help them, give them constructive criticism, give them encouragement to build them up and make the staff better than what it is today. The ministries of this church are not broken. We need somebody to come in and help it, move it along, and make it even better than what it is today. Give us the heart, if we don't get the person that we want, not to be bitter, not to be angered over it. Let's just continue to pray and make sure that the new person, if he's not who we wanted, that we can come to love him and we can all together gather around him and grow this church so we can see people saved, see people baptized, and grow this church and help Poplar Bluff and the community around us. We love you so much, Lord, and we can't do this without you. We know that. Bless this church. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. He's fighting for us. What a friend we have in Jesus. Let's stand together and sing this wonderful hymn.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Are we weak and heavy laden? Of care, precious Savior, still our refuge. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Find a solace there.
Amen.
All right, if you would, please grab your Bibles. You'll need those, so please grab your Bible or devices. It won't be on the screen tonight, and that's okay. It's just a very short three verses. So if you don't have a device or your Bible, you can read along or listen along with me as I read. Romans chapter 3. We'll start in verse 10 and go to verse 12. A very familiar passage of Scripture. If you've ever had a chance of leading someone to the Lord or talking to somebody, you've probably read through these verses. So let's read. Romans chapter 3, verse 10. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good. No, not one. Let's pray together tonight as Brother Scott Payne will come and open up Word of Truth and use it in our hearts. I think I've enjoyed his study through the book of Romans, and I know I'll enjoy this message tonight. Let's open our hearts to the preaching of the Word. Father in heaven, Lord, thank you for the opportunity we had to be at your house tonight. Thank you for the great preaching this morning. Thank you for all the extension ministries that were happening at the same time, from bus church to junior church to nursery and children's church. Thank you so much for those ministries. Thank you for the ministry of Sunday school. Lord, I ask that you'd be with us again tonight, be with Brother Scott as he opens up the Word of Truth and uses it in our hearts and lives. Help us to apply it. Help us to leave different than we walked in tonight. Lord, thank you so much for what you're going to do and continue to do. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Chris. Good evening. Well, wasn't that a wonderful choir song tonight, that God fights for us? Amen. I was thinking as they were singing about how that David stood before Goliath, and by all logic, he didn't have a chance, did he? He was just a kid. Goliath had been a warrior since he was a kid. David tried Saul's armor on. It was too big for him. He said, I can't use this. Goliath even had somebody carrying his shield before him. It was so big. And Goliath said, come on out here, boy. I'm going to feed you to the birds today. And David said something to this effect. He said, you come with me, come against me with a spear and a sword. But he said, I come to you in the name of the Lord. And he said, you're going to know today that there's a God in Israel that you've defied, because the battle's his and not mine. God's the one that did the fighting that day. And Goliath fell, had his head removed with his own sword, and the whole Philistine army fled, didn't they? That's what happens whenever we allow God to fight for us. Have you ever tried to do something on your own? Or maybe you were watching your kids and they were at that age where they said, leave me alone, I can do this, but you knew they couldn't. And finally you said, okay, just go ahead and try it. And then when they were flat on their face, they were ready for you to help them up and go on again. I wonder how many times God looks at my life, at your life, and says, really? You want to try that on your own again? I love the old hymn that says, I need thee every hour. Every hour. We sang a newer rendition of it, Lord, I need you here once in a while. I know that I need him tonight. As we continue on, we're going to look back at Bad News Gone Good, part two tonight. Appreciate Brother Chris reading for us there in Romans chapter 3. And before we begin tonight, I want to review this morning just a little bit. And I want you to remember our base camp from this morning. Can somebody tell me what that verse was before they put it on the screen? Romans 1, 7. Exactly. Good. You aced the pop quiz tonight. To all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now I trust as you thought of this morning's message and that giant bee sting that we kind of all felt a little bit this morning, that you continually ran back to this base camp and remembered that God's intent for you and God's intent as he shares his word with you through whatever means he shares it, whether it be a group singing up here or whether it be someone knocking on your door and sharing it, whether it be a preacher preaching from behind the pulpit or a Sunday school teacher teaching from behind a lectern. Now, not everybody has one like Brother Larry had this morning because he could spin his while he was teaching it. And I thought that was pretty nice. But you, whatever way that God's word is getting to you, God's intent is for you to understand his love for you and his heart. Now, sometimes we have to just stop and say, how did we get here? How did we get to this spot? What are we getting at? Before we get to that tonight, I want to review just a minute from this morning. How did we get here in this passage tonight? First, we saw this morning God's revelation about sin. And we talked about the light of creation and how that whenever we look around, we can see that somebody made this. I was told a story by a missionary that visited a church I was pastoring some 30 years ago. And he conveyed how that in visiting someone in a jungle, I don't know if it was South American or perhaps African, but it was in an interior where they hadn't been much before. And he was learning the language of this tribal people. And one that he finally began to communicate with kept asking him, what's his name? What's the name? And the missionary wasn't sure exactly what he was talking about. And finally, as they could communicate a little bit more, and the missionary said, well, who are you talking about? You keep asking, what's his name? And the tribal person said, the one that made all this. Even someone with no outside input can see that this was created by someone. So we have the light of creation. We also have the light of conscience that we talked about this morning, how that there's this God-shaped hole in each of us that only God can fill, and we have this sense of knowing that we're doing wrong, and we realize that's even in the unreached world, isn't it? And then we have the light of coronation, the fact that there is a God on the throne. My wife and I, we rejoice in this once in a while as we're driving to work, and we have a 45-minute work to drive together and back home, and it gives us this wonderful time just to, we listen to music, and we've been listening to some preaching and some teaching online, and we were just rejoicing the other day on the way to work of the fact that the Ancient of Days is on the throne, and there's never a time when the throne of God is empty. Never a time. Now, you may go to someone's office tomorrow, and you may really have a critical need. You may have to like get your license renewed or get your plates renewed. It's already the 10th of March, and you're still running February plates. And I know that one of these behavior modification specialists is going to be looking at your license plates. And you're trying to get to the license bureau, and you see a sign that says, we're closed. Oh, right when I needed them, they're empty. Or you might go to the hot dog stand because you're starving, and it says, be back in half an hour, and you go away hungry. There's times whenever people will let us down, whenever they are an empty chair when we need them to be a full chair. But friends, the throne of God is never empty. And I'm glad tonight that we have that light of coronation, that I can know that there's a God in heaven. Then we talked about man's rebellion this morning. We talked about how that when they knew God, they didn't glorify him as God. Neither were they thankful. That was man understanding through the light of creation, the light of conscience, the light of coronation, that there is a God in heaven. And I realize that there's a whole world full of people, or a large portion of the world of people today, that want to deny there's a God in heaven. We mentioned the evolution-creation conflict just a little bit this morning, but do you realize that the people that are pro-evolution, and if you're here and you're pro-evolution tonight, I'm not trying to bash you. As God's word tells the truth, I want to tell you the truth tonight. And we're going to see here just in a little bit is one of the greatest ways we can show someone we love them is by telling him or her the truth. And the truth is tonight that God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God said, see, you can come here, and land, you can come here, and they said, yes, sir. And God said, let there be trees and plants, and they obeyed. And we could go on and on with that tonight. But the thing that I'm going to interject here in parentheses, Brother Scott's opinion. Like most of you, I think my opinion's right, but I will concede that it's just my opinion right here. That their problem is not with the fact that they don't agree with the fact that God could speak and something could come into existence. Their issue with creation is if there is a creator and a creation, that means there is a God. And if there is a God, that means I'm compelled to obey him. And that's where the rub's at, friends. They're not so, quite frankly, it takes more faith to believe evolution than it does creation. For me to think that this all just accidentally happened? Brother Sean and I were talking this morning about God's sense of humor. And we weren't talking about each other. Right? We were talking about things like giraffes. And that thing in Australia that has a duck's bill and beaver's tail and all those different things. And I was thinking on the way home, I know this is silly. You know, God said, well, we got all these spare parts, just make something. You know? Now, I know that's not the way it was. I'm joking. But that's what it looks like, doesn't it? It takes a lot more faith to believe this just accidentally happened than it does to know the truth that God said, be, and it was. The Bible says concerning Jesus that everything was made, he made. That's including me and you. And then after we saw man's rebellion, we saw sin's results today. We saw that downward spiral. And as I thought about that, as I thought about the necessity of preaching that, and so many of you have been so kind to me today, and you come and said, oh, appreciate you handling a hard passage, and I appreciate your prayers, and I appreciate your understanding. That's a hard passage. It's a lot more fun to preach the butterflies than it is the bee stings, but I would be doing you a disservice not to share with you the whole counsel of God's Word. So, what's the why? I mean, I'm a military guy. You know, if I'm going to take something to my commander, I don't just need to take the what to him or her, I need to take the why. And for those of you military people, you know you never take a problem to your commander without taking a solution, or at least three or four courses of action for a solution. So the why of this tonight is that this is scriptural truth that you and I need. That's why I'm here tonight. I mean, I'm going to speculate, and I could ask some professionals in here, I'm going to speculate that with the sun on the water the last couple days, the fish are probably starting to bite. Now, my father-in-law taught me that when those yellow forsythia bushes are blooming, it's time to go crappie fishing. And there's a whole row of them up my driveway, and they're just like blaze yellow right now. And I hear them every time I drive up the driveway. They say, go fishing. Go fishing. And I'll hear them. Yeah, I know I'd get an amen out of you, Brother Joe. I hear them. But you know what? I'd rather be here tonight telling you the truth. Because the truth is what you and I need tonight. Now, we might think I need to go fishing, and I get that way sometimes. And I'm sure God will give me that opportunity in the future. But right now, I need to be here telling you the truth. Sometimes the truth hurts. We've always been taught that honesty is the best policy, and that's the right teaching. Now, I know some of you men are sitting here right now and saying, amen, Brother Scott, but what happens when my spouse asks me if I like that new hairdo? I'm going to help you just a little bit. If you'll accept this help, I'm going to help you. You could look right into their eyes, just gaze right into their eyes. This is not a marriage seminar tonight, but just gaze right into their eyes and say, my love, I've never seen anything like it. And you can be honest. Now, if she asks you some of those other questions, like how does this outfit make me look, you know, and you can put whatever adjective in there, I'm sorry, you're on your own. Honesty is the best policy, and God has done us no different. God tells us the truth. God doesn't sugarcoat it. And even concerning the people in the Bible, God doesn't sugarcoat them either, does he? I read somewhere whenever Abraham Lincoln had a portrait being painted, and maybe it was his presidential portrait, I don't know, and they asked how he wanted to be painted. He said, warts and all. I think maybe Brother Steve even made reference to that in the last few months here. Warts and all. You know what? The Bible doesn't sugarcoat people, does it? If it would, it would have left out that part where Peter denied Jesus three times and throwed a cussing fit saying, I don't even know who he is. It would have left out Paul's past, wouldn't it? Paul's writing to the Christians at Rome right here, where just a few years before this, he was persecuting the Christians at Rome. Amen. And if the Bible was sugar-coated, it would have left that out, but it didn't. Why? Because God sees fit that you and I need the truth, even when it applies to us. There's no deceit or guile with God. In Paul's letter to Rome, he said, "Let God be true, but every man a liar." Back in John chapter 17, when Jesus was praying, it's what really is the Lord's Prayer. What we call the Lord's Prayer was the Lord teaching us to pray. But over in John chapter 17, you get to hear Jesus praying. And in that prayer, he's talking about you and me. He says, "I pray for my disciples, for those around here." But he said, "Also those that will believe on me through their word." That's me tonight. That's you. And here's what Jesus said. He said, "Sanctify them through thy word. Thy word is truth." God tells the truth. And these are just a couple of statements that show a whole bunch about how God only tells the truth. He is the truth. John chapter 14 and verse 6, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me." So not only does he tell the truth, he is the truth. Jesus stood before Pilate, and Pilate asked the question, "What is truth?" And he didn't have sense enough to know that the truth was right there in front of him. Tonight, I pray you open your heart to the truth of God's word about your life. He has loved you and me enough to tell us the truth about sin and about its end. So just to conclude this review before we get started tonight, this morning we talked about sin itself. We talked basically about two things this morning. We talked about the disposition of sin, the place that it puts us in. The Bible says in Romans 1 and 22, the last part of it as we read this morning, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. And I read lots of times in the Bible where it talks about the word folly. Talks about the fool has said in his heart, "There's no God." Talks about someone who's consumed with folly. And we've kind of hijacked that word. We've hijacked a lot of words in the English language, haven't we? We've kind of hijacked that word and made it to mean silly or funny or something like that. And whenever I say someone is a fool, we'd say, well, maybe they're dumb, or they're, we might use the word stupid. And I know you're not supposed to use the word stupid, but gosh, sometimes it really applies. And say they're just stupid, or they're silly, or they like to act funny, they're acting foolish. We might even tell our kids, stop acting foolish. But the context that it's talking about right here is a very serious thing. It says, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. That doesn't mean that God's looking at them and saying, "Oh, them silly things." No, they're forsaking the fact that there's a God. And that's the disposition of sin tonight. Did you know that before you were saved, before I was saved, God called us his enemy? Before I was in Christ, I was at enmity, the Bible says, with God. Diametrically opposed to the heart of God. Now I have peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. I've been reconciled to him. The Bible says Jesus is the propitiation, satisfactory payment for my sin. And now when God looks at me, Brother Sean, he sees Jesus' righteousness. I'm no longer his enemy, I'm his child. And you might say, well, we're all children of God. Well, not biblically speaking, we're not. We're all creations of God. Jesus, whenever he was talking to some of the Pharisees right there, and they said, "We're Abraham's children." He said, "You're not Abraham's children. You're the devil's children." He said, "If you were Abraham's children, you'd be rejoicing that I'm here. And here you are trying to kill me." I'm paraphrasing. You go back and read it. So not everyone is a child of God, but upon faith in Christ and being justified, we are God's child. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. And we also saw this morning the depravity of sin. And I don't need to spend a lot of time there because you remember what that swirling bowl, downward spiral was this morning. It just got worse and worse and worse as I read that list, didn't it? And I didn't spend a lot of time there. One, I didn't feel like it's where God wanted me to spend the time this morning. But two, it's just an uncomfortable place to be. And nobody likes to talk about that. It's one of those things, those Bible doctrines, somebody said it at the back door, said it's one of those things we think about, we just kind of let it slip on by. Sometimes we just need to stop and look at it. I teach suicide intervention for the Army and some in the civilian world as well. And, whenever I'm working with someone who is at the point where he or she is actually thinking about suicide, we kind of use a word picture to consider how they might be feeling. And we talk about them standing alone in the dark, staring at this big old billboard that's lit up in the night, and it just says death and the past and alone, and how they're just looking at those things, feeling lower and lower and alone. But you know what? The truth is that God loves them, and he loves you and me. And we don't want to look at that like we want to look at this downward spiral. But sometimes we just need to get right there with that person and look at it and say, man, that's awful. Put our arm around them and say, let's look over here a little while. And we begin to tell them about life. As a minister, as a chaplain, I begin to tell them about Jesus. And begin to tell them how much they're loved. And how much God wants to love on them. And how that he loved them so much, as I said this morning, that he gave his life for them even while they were in sin. And we can help turn somebody from that old dark billboard, help turn them from this old dark spiral to a better view. Some of you have looked at property and built houses and different things like that. And probably part of what you did when you looked at that piece of property or you built that house, you considered what the view would be. And my view is a soybean field, and I'm okay with that. But maybe you have a view where you're looking out over a pond, or city people would call it a lake, but it's a pond, right? And you're looking out over a pond, or maybe you're looking out over the mountains. The chaplain assistant that I deployed with a couple years ago, he lives over in the Appalachian Mountains of western North Carolina, and you can actually see the Appalachian Trail from his back porch or his front porch. I don't know which side of the house it's on, but we sat there and drank some tea a couple summers ago, and he says, yep, the Appalachian Trail runs right over that hill over there. I'm thinking, man, this is a really nice view. Well, we all like the nice views, but sometimes we need to stop and look at reality. And that's what this scripture has done for us today. Tonight, let's look about the truth about the sinner himself or herself. We looked at the sin this morning. Tonight, let's look at the sinner. Here's what scripture teaches us tonight. First, we learn that the heathen is guilty. Now, this is all about establishing guilt tonight so that, Lord willing, in the next sermon, we can talk about what God has chosen to do with that. Tonight, we're looking at first, the heathen is guilty. And I'm looking at some of the scripture that we read this morning, Romans chapter 1, verse 18 through 21. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of time here, because this is where we spent all of our time this morning, but I just need to remind you of the one statement in there says, when they knew God. That's important. That tells me that God revealed himself to them. And that removes all that argument of, well, they've never heard. When they knew God. Now, I'm going to tell you something. The Bible will mess up your theology. It really will. And I just mentioned a verse of scripture a while ago. It said, let God be true and every man a liar. That includes me. If I get something out of whack with God's word, guess who's in the wrong? I am. And if you get something out of whack with God's word, guess who's in the wrong? You are. So we want to understand tonight that they did have the opportunity to know God. You say, well, before you go on tonight, what's the big deal about this? Here's one takeaway I want you to get from this point. Again, I'm not going to stay here long because we spent this morning's time on it. This should change how you and I view missions. This should change how you and I view personal soul winning. This should change how you and I view, and boy, I know that I'm preaching not just to the choir that went down and sat down, but the whole church as a choir tonight, because everything in this church is centered around sharing the gospel. And Brother Chris stood up and said, may we never take for granted the fact that we're seeing baptisms and people saved and people called to ministries. Boy, I agree with him 100%. But do you realize God is blessing and using this church because you're trying to make everything about him? I've been at several different churches over the years, ministered at several different churches, and not every church conducts itself like Westwood does. Now, I don't get the big head or something on me here, but I'm telling you, whenever you make everything about Jesus, then Jesus is in everything. And I pray that no matter what the coming months and years and decades hold, that it will always be that way here at this church family, that we will always keep sharing the gospel message at the very center of everything we do. Why? Because even those that haven't heard are guilty before God. So first, we have the heathen is guilty. Second tonight, we have the hypocrite is guilty. I'm going to move into Romans chapter 2. And as I told you this morning, I'm going to be jumping around in these 1, 2, and 3 for the next couple sermons as we keep going back to that base camp of Romans chapter 1, verse 7 at the end of each. I'm reading from Romans chapter 2, verses 1 through 6. It'll be on the screen. Therefore thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest. For wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself. For thou that judgest doeth the same things. But we are sure the judgment of God is according to truth against them which commit such things. And thinkest thou this, O man, that judgest them which do such things? Let's put some parentheses right there. What such things is he talking about? Everything that was at the end of chapter 1 that we talked about this morning. That's the such things that he's talking about right there. And thinkest thou this, O man, that judgest them which do such things and doest the same, that thou shalt escape the judgment of God? Or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance? But after thy hardness and impenitent heart, treasurest up unto thyself wrath against the day of judgment and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who will render to every man according to his deeds. Wow, that's a mouthful of scripture right there, isn't it? Here's what's being said. He says, you're doing something and you're judging somebody else. And the statement they're going to put up in a minute, we can't judge ourselves by our intentions and somebody else by their actions. And sometimes we do that. God labels this kind of judgment inexcusable. Now here's what we do. We look at somebody else. Can I use you as an example, Brother Sean? I'm going to do that because he called me Major Payne like the 9th time today. That's okay, I can take it. If I look at Brother Sean, I say, oh, that dirty dog, you should see what he did. And he did this, 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 and this. And I might do the same thing, but in my mind I'm saying, well, I did it because I was tired, or I did it because I was running late, or I did it because somebody had offended me. You see where I'm going at? I'm judging him by what he did, but I'm judging myself by what I meant. And it doesn't work that way. That's what's going on right here. God's talking to the person who says, well, at least I'm not as bad as those people that you talked about earlier in your letter. At least I'm not as bad as them. And God's word is saying, hey, wait a minute, you're doing exactly the same thing. And you think you're going to escape? The Bible calls that inexcusable. Inexcusable. Now, even if you do this kind of judgment, your standard is all off. You know, sometimes we have measurement standards and they're not right. Go ahead and put that picture up. I don't know if you can see this or not, but as a shop teacher, this makes me cringe. And for every carpenter and handyman, handywoman person, you're going to go home and check your tape measures. Now I know. And I really agree with this picture, why I have trust issues. If those of you say, what's so funny? You look where the 2-inch marks are. And those are both two brand new tape measures. They're standards off, isn't it? When I was in the Navy a lifetime ago, one of my jobs was calibrating test equipment. Because whenever I would put this test probe here and it was going to read a certain frequency, I needed to know that the test equipment was actually reading that. I needed to have a good standard. And that's what we called we had to send our stuff out to a higher level calibration lab so that we could use it as a standard. You say, why are you showing us all this stuff? Hey, whenever you judge yourself against somebody else, your standard is off. Whenever you say, well, they did this, but I didn't, or they're doing this worse or better than I am, your standard's off. You're measuring against yourself. The Bible says back in verse 2 of what I just read there in Romans chapter 2 that God judges according to truth. He says, you're inexcusable, O man, that judges, because you're looking at yourself and saying, well, they're doing, I'm not. And he said, you're a hypocrite. He said, but God judges according to truth. And I'm going to tell you something tonight. Some of you are going to judge me, and I'm okay with that. But if you're going to judge me, at least judge me to a good standard. If you're going to say, Brother Scott, I'm going to judge you and compare you, now that's not a very biblical thing for you to be doing, but some of you might. Here's how I want you to judge me. I want you to compare me to Jesus. Compare my righteousness to His. Compare my love and my heart to His. And you know what you're going to find? You're going to find that I am absolutely nothing. You're going to find that I mean, the Bible says there's not anything good in me. Paul said there's not anything good in here. It's like when you open the refrigerator on the day before you get groceries. There's nothing in here. Or if you have a teenager in the house, you open the refrigerator door, there's nothing in here. Hey, if you're going to measure me against a good standard. And then let's take it one step further. You go ahead and measure yourself by the same standard. And you know what you're going to find? You're going to find the ground's level all the way around the cross. We're all in the same boat on that. So if you're going to judge, at least judge by a good standard. Judge according to what? According to truth. I'm glad the ground is level at the cross. Now, I'm not encouraging to judge one another. Please don't think that I am. I'm just saying that it's in our nature to do so. We're human beings. You say, well, we're saved human beings. You are, and I praise the Lord for it. But you know what? You're still in the middle of a big old wrestling match that we're going to talk about when we get over to Romans chapter 7. And we're going to be in that big old wrestling match. You know, we in the verses that they read this morning on the, what's that big thing called? Screen. I'm nervous in front of y'all. Y'all are scary. You know that? Shouldn't have been so funny. It said we wrestle with an E on there. And I thought wrestle's got an A in it. It sounds like wrestle if you say it in Wayne County. Okay? So we got this big wrestling match. And I have fun poking fun at my English teacher wife. I go back and I have kids that go from my class to her class. And I tell them, you go back and tell Mrs. Payne that learning English is important, but learning shop is importanter. And they do, don't they? I'll give them extra credit tomorrow when I get to school. But we got this big wrestling match that we're going through, and if you can't wait till I get there in Romans chapter 7, go home and read it. And you're going to find there where the Apostle Paul says, and I'm paraphrasing, he said, I look for the good and I see the evil in me. He said, I don't want to do the bad and I end up doing it. And he said, I try and do good, but there's still, he said, and finally he cried out, O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? That was the Apostle Paul. I hold him in pretty high regard. I figure if there was a maturing Christian of the time, it was him. God used him in a great way, saw all these churches started, made all these mission trips, suffered all these things for Christ. And you know what Paul said? He said, O wretched man that I am. The ground is level at the foot of the cross, friends. So we have the heathen is guilty, we have the hypocrite is guilty, and finally tonight we have the Hebrew is guilty. Notice, if you would, at the beginning of in Romans chapter 3, verses 19 through 20, the Bible says, Now we know what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before God. Therefore, by the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. So finally, in this section, we consider the Jewish person. Now, this Jewish person is a very blessed person because they are God's chosen people. If you look back over in the Old Testament, they're called the apple of God's eye. I believe they still are, by the way. And I believe the things that God promised them are still in effect today. And I believe that God's plans for them are still on track and on target. I realize that that becomes a politically hot topic in the world today, but that doesn't change the fact that they're God's chosen people. It doesn't change the fact that we as a people and we as a nation should stand with them. Even though they have such an advantageous position, they are not above the judgment of God. I mean, you and I are gathering here tonight partially because of their rejection of Him, aren't we? And the gospel was sent to them, they rejected. The gospel was sent to the Gentiles. Personally, I believe God knew that was going to happen. I don't believe anything was an emergency band-aid fix with God. God said, well, plan A didn't work, let's try plan B. No, I believe God knew you, and I believe He loved you at the foundation of the world. I mean, whenever John looked at Jesus, he said, as a lamb slain before the foundation of the world. God's plan was in place before He said, let there be light. But these Jewish people, although they are God's chosen, Scripture addresses them as guilty just like it addresses the rest of us. Actually, in the verses that I just read, it says that the whole world may be guilty before God. So why are you preaching such a downer message? Just hold with me for a couple more minutes. There is no nationality or race that's outside the bounds of God's degree of guilt in these passages of Scripture. No getting around it. There's not a race, there's not a color, there's not a nationality, there's not a social group, there's not a socioeconomic group, there's nobody that's outside the bounds of this. I know there are some groups out there who erroneously think that they're the only ones going to heaven because they do one certain thing or have one certain verse that they've wrung a whole doctrine out of that one verse. But friends, the truth is that God's word places everyone guilty before the Lord, and that Jesus said, "Whosoever believeth." I'm glad for that tonight. Now, we've seen the whole world's conviction of guilt before a thrice holy God. For those who have not heard, to those that look to their own works and think they're not so bad compared to the person next to them, to the chosen people of God, we're all guilty before Him. You say, wow, what a way to start a week, Brother Scott. Let's run back to base camp before we quit tonight. Back to Romans chapter 1, verse 7. I'm going to read it to you again, and I hope you don't grow weary of me reading this verse to you. To all that be in Rome, and to you and me tonight, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, as tough as all these passages of Scripture are from tonight and this morning, and as much as they sting, we know they're here for our good. The passages that I preached about this morning, the passages that I made reference to tonight, are in the same letter that the verse for our base camp is at. So if you picture this, we think in chapter and verse, but that was literally hundreds of years later when chapters and verses were applied to these letters. And it was a reference method for you and me to be able to get to a certain spot. This was a letter that Paul wrote to Rome. So if you look at it as one letter, right at the beginning of this whole area where Paul just drags him down a gravel road, he says, you're beloved of God. You're called to be saints. Why is that? For my personal soul winners in here, isn't the hardest person to witness to the person that doesn't see that they're guilty? If you've ever done any door-to-door soul winning or bus ministry or however you've been interacting one-on-one with somebody, then I'm sure that you have interacted with someone that says, well, I live a pretty good life. I'm not as bad as the people across the street. I mean, there's a meth lab and all these different things. My wife and I lived in a town one time, and I think there was several really bad things going on in a house across the street. There was people coming and going all hours of the days and night, and I thought, man, I was nervous for the well-being of my babies. But some people might look and say, well, I'm not so bad. I'm not like them. Or I was raised in church. Or, well, I was baptized. Or, I've performed whatever work in some works-based religions. I've done this, or I've received this, or I've taken this, or I've said this, or whatever. And they might have all these reasons, but they're not saved because they don't perceive their guilt. Now, you and I won't argue them into guilt. I'm not going to go to somebody and say, hey, this is what it says. But God's Spirit can crack that old cold heart open. I mean, we measure power in all different kinds of ways in the world. We measure torque, and we measure horsepower. We measure amperage, and we measure voltage, and we measure, you know, megatons of nuclear detonative power and all these different things. But there's no power in the universe like the power of God's Spirit to take an old cold heart and begin to warm it up and crack it wide open where He can speak to somebody. That's power. That's power tonight. I can't do that. Brother Larry can't do that. Brother Chris, Brother Sean, none of the others can do that. But friends, God sure can. And whenever He establishes this to the Christians at Rome, He's saying, hey, God loves you, and God's called you, but here's some things you need to understand. Paul told them those things because he loved them, and he knew God loves them. And it's the same reason you and I need to hear these things tonight. His salutation, his greeting, and hope for those at Rome remained unchanged throughout his whole description of the downward spiral. While he was telling about all those bad things that we talked about this morning, he's wanting them to remember, hey, you're beloved of God. God loves you. God's proclamation to us tonight is still, just like in this seventh verse of chapter 1, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. You and I can experience God's grace and peace right here, right now. I don't know where your hearts are at tonight. I know this is the Sunday night crowd. But you know what? Sometimes that's the crowd God's speaking to. With knowledge comes responsibility. If you've raised kids or grandkids, there was a time whenever you understood they didn't know something. They might have done something, and you say, that's not what I want you to do. And you maybe had to correct them, but from then on, you held them accountable for what they knew, didn't you? Some of you are thinking in Marvel movie terms right now, and you're hearing Spider-Man's uncle saying, with great power comes... Oh, I knew a couple of you had at least seen it. Great responsibility, all right? With knowledge comes responsibility. From the very beginning, God has manifested the knowledge of sin to all. What a blessed people we are today to have God's Word and God's Holy Spirit to speak to our heart and to convict us of sin. And you might say, well, Brother Scott, I don't like it when God convicts me of sin. Well, welcome to the human race. Nobody does. But let's look at it for what it really is. I mean, our flesh says, I don't like it when God convicts me of sin. It makes me uncomfortable. It makes me think I need to change, and I don't like that. But here's what is happening in reality. This is God knocking at your heart's door and saying, hey, I love you, and I want you to be reconciled to me. I love you so much that my son died in your place. That's why he knocks on your heart's door. I mean, if you have somebody, walking toward a busy street and they're not paying attention, and you holler at them, and they don't listen, what do? You holler louder. And if they don't listen, what do? If you got time, you go grab them and you keep them off the street. Let me share this very quickly, and I'm done. We were fighting a house fire one night. I worked with Advanced Fire for a couple decades. And we were mutual aiding, I think it was Bell City. We were fighting a house fire down between Bell City and Aquila, for those of you that know those huge metropolitan areas. And the bulk of the house had burned away before we even got on scene. The other fire department had called us for manpower and for water supply. And we got there, and I remember the front facade of this gable end house was still standing. So the roof had collapsed, but the gable end of the house was still standing. Might have had a little bit of a front porch helping it leaning up. And if you're looking at the flat of the gable end like this, it started doing this. It wasn't flopping inward or outward like it was going to pancake. It was going straight sideways. The whatever, if it was plywood, I don't remember what was keeping it boxed, had failed, and the studs were starting to hinge sideways like that. One of my firefighters was on the edge of it. He couldn't see that because it was coming at him. And I hollered at him. I can't remember his name right now, but I can see his face. And I hollered at him, and he didn't answer me. And he's over there, I forget if he had a pike pole pulling out some debris. We were doing the salvage and overhaul part of it. And I hollered at him again. And finally, I laid the hose line down. I was applying water from the front of the house still yet. And I went and I got hold of his uniform, and I physically moved him away from the house. And he gave me a look like, what in the world are you doing? And of course, it's really noisy on the fire ground. I just pointed at the wall. He's like, oh. Now, he was probably a little bit sore at me because I grabbed him by the uniform and I physically moved him. But was I doing that because I was mad at him? No, I was doing that because I didn't want to see one of my men with a house laying on top of him. So you might think tonight, well, why does God convict me of my sin? Is it because he's mad at me? No, it's because he doesn't want to see you separated from him throughout eternity. He convicts us of our sin because he loves us. I pray that you'd respond to his love tonight. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for this beautiful day. Thank you for the baptisms this morning, the testimonies of people following you. Thank you for the songs, the choir songs and the worship songs. Thank you for the Sunday school lessons and the prayers and the testimonies and your word. And Lord, all of these blessings you've given us today testify of your love for us. Even as we look at your word and we see these verses that might feel a little bit uncomfortable to us as we read them because we think, wow, those are horrible things. Why are we hearing about those? And why does that make my heart feel weird inside? It's because you love us and you're tugging at our heart. Lord, I don't know people's hearts here tonight, but I know that you do. And I pray that as we move into this time of invitation, God, that you would work the work in our hearts that only you can do. And I ask for that in Jesus' name. Now, with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, I want to ask you just to consider God speaking to your heart tonight. I don't know the needs here tonight, but maybe there's something you'd like to pray about. Maybe there's something on your heart that you want to pray about. Maybe there's somebody here and you think, wow, those are things that aren't very good. And you're talking about God loving us enough that He wants to save us from those. And you'd like to know more about that tonight. This would be the best time of your life to get that nailed down tonight. Maybe you're here and you just want a special time of prayer for this time of transition. For whatever your need is tonight, this altar's open. I'm going to ask Brother Chris to come and lead us in this time of invitation.